Good evening, Fleet Activities Yokosuka. I am Captain Dave Glenister. With me, as always, is Master Chief King. And welcome to all of our folks here in Yokosuka, out in Nikkego, Nagishi, and all of you tuning in from wherever you're tuning in, YouTube and elsewhere. So we're going to spend some time talking about some topics of recent relevance, get to some ICE comments, which I have here, 42 pages of them, spanning about a month's worth of comments. And we'll talk about some relevant issues here. So first, I'd like to say this is being recorded the day after we went through Tropical Storm 16 Whiskey, also known as Man Yi, for those of you who are tuning in and watching some of the television programs that cover that or websites that cover that as well. So pretty good, as far as tropical storms go, it was a pretty good execution by Sifei and the tenants and the ships, to include the ships, I believe, in getting ready for that tropical storm.
Yes, sir. They did a great job. The family members as well took care of all their business at their residences. We didn't have any missile hazards flying around from items left outdoors. So everybody did a great job staying indoors when they were supposed to.
And the big piece of this thing is obviously on our side, putting the word out of what the plan is. And I guess for the families, them giving us the ability to get them the word.
Yes.
So we have some avenues for doing that.
The comments that we received on Facebook and all of the other venues that we had that we put the information out were very positive. We did get ahead of this one, and the entire installation did a great job on it.
Yeah, so I'm not going to lie to you. There are some times where we may lean too far forward, in which case we will fall down. And by that I mean we might start closing things down. We might, you know, not send the buses out for the school kids to bring them into school. And then it becomes a big old nothing burger. Blue skies, no problem. And what happened, you know, we've impacted operations. We've impacted SRF's ability to keep repairing those ships. We've impacted the teacher school schedules. And so I'm going to say in advance that I regret for those times when that happens. I'm not going to say I'm sorry, because we make that risk assessment and we judge all those things in the right context, and then we kind of move forward on that. The ones that happen over a weekend are obviously a little tougher to judge. The reality is that we can't always bring everyone in, or we won't have everyone here at the time to do things. So we got to lean a little further forward. So now, as far as getting the word out, we have several different ways of doing that. We saw that, actually had one comment on Facebook: can you put some sign at the main gate? Apart from the big marquee, which we turned on.
Yes, we did.
I'm not sure what kind of big sign we could put there. But we did. And that's off most of the time for energy savings. But we did turn that one on. We also tried to, instead of just saying we're going to TCOR, which is Tropical Cyclone Condition of Readiness, we try to actually say what we want people to do, like stay inside or close off your doors and windows against heavy rain and things like that. So, but there is, I wanted to make a plug here. There is something that's called a computer desktop notification system, and that is this little bubbles that pop up on the screen if you are on a OneNet computer. But they also have the ability to send out emails to whatever emails you want and make phone calls. And I will go on record and say I will not send a phone call to you at 4 in the morning unless I absolutely need to for some information. Like this time, we knew we were going to have 35 knot winds at 4 in the morning. We chose not to activate the phone because we can select what parts and pieces get activated. So I would encourage people to sign up for that. And there is an email address to send your information to, and we'll put a slide together to say where it goes, but basically it is cfay-cdns@fe.navy.mil, and you put your name, your sponsor, your command, but primarily the email address and the phone numbers you want us to contact, and those will be the long version of those phone numbers, not DSN, because I think the phone calls come from San Diego or something, don't they? It is something like that.
I think so, sir.
I don't know. I'm putting Massey on the spot. I'm putting myself on the spot. We shouldn't do that. But we'll figure that out. We'll put that on the slides. Hopefully, you'll be seeing that right now. But I encourage you to do that. And we won't be calling you at 3 in the morning unless there's something you really need to do something actionable. It's information. We'll may follow that up during daylight hours with another notification. But the emails are good. Got a bunch of new chiefs running around this base.
Yes, sir, we do. For CFA and some of the tenants, we just pinned 29 brand new chief petty officers at the theater. It was a very good season, and please congratulate all of our newest chiefs afloat and ashore and Navy-wide, because they did a great job. It was a great season. A lot of changes this season. Those changes were for the good, and these chiefs are ready to take on the responsibility of being the chief petty officer, Kevin.
Yeah, I went out and about shortly after that ceremony, saw a lot of them out with their families and things like that.
Sir.
And I suspect there's probably a good number went right back to work to get ready for this tropical storm.
Yes, they did.
Doing what chiefs got to do. I've always found it a bit, I never liked the churn. Sometimes a lot of the E6s, they transition to E7, and suddenly we lose them off of our commands because they've got, you know, places to be, things to fill. But there's two sides to that. And one is that, you know, you have that, you know, that sharp E6, obviously sharp because he just made E7 moving on. And we want him to have the opportunity to do great things on another ship and give chance for that the other folks left behind to step up.
Absolutely, Ken. I don't know what we're going to have this year for realignment of CPOs with our budget constraints.
It does cost money to move you.
It does happen. But it was a great year. Guys did great. And like you said, sir, they were all back at work on Friday, getting ready for the weekend and Monday.
Yeah, it is a much better CPO season. You know, back when we first came in, there was a one, they invited us brand new ensigns to be a part of the initiation. And it was a lot more of a rite of passage in a negative hazing sense than it really was a training period for those folks transferring to that kind of leadership role. And I think the Navy's really got it right this time.
Yes, sir.
As we move forward, so that's good. Okay. So let me shift gears here a little bit and talk about the housing assignment policy. Now, as you know, there's a lot of dissatisfiers out there, a lot of dissatisfied folks. And as we try to comply with some of the housing guidance, we have housing here in military family housing on OCONUS primarily. We do have some in CONUS as well. And we pay money for that housing. And if we can't put you into that housing, folks will go out in town. And
yes,
it costs more money. That's the kind of the big picture thing. So we want to make the most, be good stewards of taxpayer dollars, and so we want to make sure we are at least over 90% of our units are filled with military families. That's what it's there for. It costs us roughly, very roughly, but about $20,000 more per family in town than it does for family on base. And with about 1,000 families out in town, that's a big chunk of change that the military is paying that they would not normally have to. And some of that has been because of the previous assignment policies. So what have we done? We said, well, you come here, you're going to live in military housing, military family housing, if it's available. So, but one of the things that we are trying to get better at is giving you your choice of what military houses are available to you. And recently, and you'll see this on Facebook, people will drive around and they'll say, look, my house is on this street and there's a house next to me that's open. You should ask for that. Have you
yes,
heard
sir.
This?
Yeah. I get a lot of feedback on that. Mm-hmm. And the reality is that there's a long process in making those, once we move a previous resident out and getting it ready for the next resident to move in, we could be replacing appliances, we could be taking care of damage that's occurred in the unit, or other services that we're waiting on prior to turning it over. So I think the new idea that we're going to generate here for the public, and I'll let you have that one, Captain.
Thank you.
But we do need to have to ask the community to, you have to have patience, because just because a unit is ready does not mean it's ready to be moved into, just because it's vacant.
Right. And one of the things we've done, we're starting to roll this out, is just put signs on those units that are not available. I know you're out and about. You're shopping around, looking at your neighborhood where you think you might want to live, and getting some feedback from the neighbors. So there are reasons why housing units are not available for any period of time. Sometimes the turnover, which it does cost money to turn over a house, about $7,500 a unit every time we turn it over. We can talk about that more when we talk about why we don't just move you when you promote, right? But also there's routine scheduled maintenance. Some houses and towers will go down for a period of time where we renovate the whole thing. Some are down for inspections. We have to do some of these things. In fact, we have a Department of Defense Inspector General team that is going around visiting military family housing all over the world, looking for just kind of material condition things. They're looking for trends. They're looking for stuff. And they'll come by with some instruments. If you see them, they'll be out there doing routine, like you'd have a house inspector. Will come by with his sniffer and his whiz bang, and they look for, you know, what are there? Is there mold? Is there, you know, the sockets wired wrong, or whatever it is? And you'll see them. They're making their way around through Japan, so you may see them in the next weeks or coming ahead. Routine stuff, and so part of that, you know, we have some units that we take out of service, and so we're going to put signs on those units, so you'll have an understanding of why the house that's next door to you is not in service. Why it's not being filled and things like that, because that's a reasonable question. Why, you know, is it haunted? My house is haunted. Did you know my house is haunted?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I saw the ghost in your garage when I was driving by.
Yeah, I think so. It was some elderly caretaker at one stage. No, my house is haunted. There's a couple other good places. Great for Halloween, not great the rest of the year. Though I have not seen any apparitions, but apparently several COs ago, lived in only one wing of the house or something. I don't know. But that's probably not the reason why these houses are available. But we'll put a sign out there that says that. So, housing assignment policy. We have a mandate to fill our housing. We are about a little over 90% of Yokosuka housing is now in use of available houses. We have probably 70% of Akego.
Just about, sir.
And climbing. So if you wonder why folks that come here are generally getting signed to Ikego, it's because that's where the houses are that are available. And there's that normal routine turnover thing. We assign, and it depends on the time of year, between, I don't know, I think as low as maybe 15 and as many as 50 in a month.
Yes.
Depending on peak times, that's a lot of assignments to be made. And so what they have been doing, those of you who know this, they've been going down the list and saying, here's the unit available, this is what's available, this is what's available to you, based on pay grade and family members and situations and things that you provide them. But what we're going to do in a pilot program, because we got to, you know, build a little, test a little, learn a lot, as you just say in the AEGIS program, so we're going to roll this pilot program out, get your feedback for those of you who are being assigned, and see how what's the level of pain and administratively to just say, okay, here's everything that's available right now on this list. Pick anyone you want. Okay, now, you say, well, that's easy. Well, that's easy if you already know what units are on there.
Yes.
And you can't say, oh, give me an hour, I'm going to go drive around. Because when you come back, there's five other people who are also chomping at the bit, looking at those townhouses that are on there, as opposed to the high-rise or whatever. So, you know, and we don't want to make it like a giant bakery where you take a number, and we don't want to break out the sumo suits and have a fight out there in front of the Navy Lodge to see who gets that townhouse. So, but there are going to be some a little bit of churn with this. So we're going to roll it out, as I said, like a pilot program. We'll ask you if you want to participate or not. And if you do, we'll kind of go through this, and we'll learn a lot from you folks as well as we do that. But in my mind, it seems reasonable that our mandate is that we use the houses that the government has already paid for as taxpayers and us as stewards of taxpayer dollars.
Yes.
So, but I think we can do that by just saying, hey, here's what's available. Take any one of these, as long as you rate it.
Sir, I think it's going to be a huge actual plus for all our inbound families, because although Akego does have the most available units, Akego is really not that far away. It's about a 17-minute drive. You do have the option of taking 16 or the toll road. We do get COLA. But having a new family come in and being able to have an option makes them part of the process. Whereas instead of us just saying, sorry, this is the first unit on the list, you have to move in here. I think this is gonna hopefully get some very good positive reactions from our families coming in.
I hope so. One of the things we're gonna ask also is, what's kind of your dream sheet there? What kind of stuff would you like? We may ask, if you would have preferred, were you offered it, to live out in town as well, which we don't have that option now until we get our housing units up to required level, which is over 90%. But for the future, as we move on, I mean, this base is going to be here, and we'll, you know, other housing units, other housing policies come along. I'd like to kind of understand how many people are actually have some level of satisfaction and how many people are getting none of their choices. Yeah, to your point on the Akego thing, yeah, it is 15 minutes. I see there are some comments that say it takes 45. Said you live there, I live there. I was out there. I went out there for some kind of scout meeting. I went out there just to tour around some of the construction and things. It does not take that long. And I will share with you, and I have actually put this into some folks who have asked for a waiver because they got to live on the main base, which actually you don't in many cases. But if you were back in CONUS and you were assigned to whatever command, would they make you live within 5 minutes of your ship? No, they would not. In fact, it takes longer to get through the gate in San Diego and Norfolk once you've queued up to go through than it does to drive from Akego.
Yes, it does, sir.
Absolutely. And having done both of those, I will share with you. So I understand you want to live in the main base, but, you know, Akego is very nice.
Akego is a beautiful area, sir. Yeah. There's you have Zushi City right there. The housing is awesome out there. The landscape, we have the campgrounds. Club Takamaya is a great facility. We just completed the renovation out there at that one, too. And it's actually kind of gets you away from the industrial areas that most of Yokosuka is, and you're actually in a housing area, vice having the industrial portion that you have to drive through to get home. So yeah, it's a great place.
It is, and I will say, being that its function is to support the residents take care of the place. You don't have a lot of yellow gear moving around, trucks and things like that, but you also don't have water bottles and Coke cans and wrappers shoved in bushes and things like that, which, you know, we have our folks out after the weekend. They come through, they can clean this place up. And so folks who live here, please take a round turn on that. Don't dump your trash. And I'm going to try and work and see if I need more trash cans here and there. But you don't see that kind of stuff out of the Akego because people know that's their backyard. In some cases, literally their backyard. So, and it does give you the confidence to kind of drive through Japan. I found after living in Akego, I was much more apt to drive up to Tokyo because I already knew how to drive in town. So, well, anyway, so that's a very long answer to a question you didn't even ask. But what we'll say is, you know, Akego is a great place to live, and we're going to continue to assign folks based on what is available. So I know folks will continue to ask for, I've got to be on base. The answer is you probably don't. Some of you do. And those of you that do, you're already kind of billeted into that. And those that don't, you know, give it a try. Take a drive out there. Take a train out there. It is really nice out there. Okay. So, taking a look at my producer over here. He's going to give me a high sign here in a few seconds. All right. So, we're going to take a break here in a few minutes. You're all saying thank you for that. but we'll take a break in a few minutes, and then we're going to come back. We're going to go through some ICE comments. But I do want to point out one thing. We've talked about housing. That's a big one. We're coming up at the end of the fiscal year. Now, what does that mean to everybody? Nothing. Okay, what does it mean to me? Quite a bit. Especially coming from the Pentagon here, where we don't really do a lot of operational stuff. We worry about the money side of things, the business side of things. End of the fiscal year means we're closing up our accounts, we're wrapping things up, and we're looking forward to October 1st, new fiscal year, normally new money. When you don't have a budget passed, as we, you know, sometimes do not, we get what's called a continuing resolution, which means that we can only fund things at the same level we had them last year. So as a word of caution, a word of note, we are not going to have this big money train sailing through Yokosuka here. That's going to open up everything like the golf nets and fix all these problems we have. And so before we go to break, the one last sobering thought here is the federal budget. Let's think about how big that is, how much money. There's so many zeros on the end of every number. It's kind of difficult to get your arms around. So I will share it to you the way that the general I worked for shared it with everybody, and Mr. Hale, the comptroller for DOD, shares it. If you can imagine, this is our budget problem. This is why the marquee is shut off. This is why We don't have the lights turned on the soccer fields and things like that. It's all about the Benjamins. Okay. Imagine you are in a family that makes $24,000 a year. Okay, that's what you got. But you are spending $36,000 a year. That is the U.S. government in a nutshell, right there. So about $2.4 trillion. We're spending $3.6 trillion. And so we are going into debt heavily. And oh, by the way, for your family that makes $36,000 or makes $24,000, spending $36,000, you now owe $160,000 on your credit card, right? $16 trillion. So add a couple zeros, and that is the problem in a nutshell. We're spending $24,000, we're making $24,000, we're spending $36,000, $12,000 a year is going on our credit card. And that's what we got. So every little bit helps. We are trying to reduce this piece. Now, DOD's piece of this budget is, you could, you know, zero out the DOD accounts and it will not solve the problem. But we are supposed to be good stewards of the American taxpayer money. We're supposed to be doing the right thing in controlling resources and doing our part. And that's why we recycle. That's why we do things like these energy conservation things. That's why I put solar panels in and all that other stuff, trying to do the right thing for money. That's why we also are not going to spend money without good reason, whether it be to travel, whether it be to move people. You know, you're now in E7, you now rate a larger house. We're not going to move you because it costs money to transition it over, and it costs money to actually move you. So with that being said, we're going to take a break here, and we'll be back with some ICE comments. Welcome back. Those of you who are just joining us, Captain Dave Glenister and Master Chief King, we're here to talk about some of your ICE comments. As you know, this is the medium by which we prefer that you give us comments on customer service issues, ideas for improvement. Navy's full of problem finders.
Oh, yes, sir.
And we can use a few problem solvers. So that's good. And ironically, here's my ironic answer, the first one. After the last Commander's Corner, there was a post on Facebook that says, hey, thanks for the feedback. Are you going to accept questions from Facebook? So I'm going to accept one, just that one, and I'm going to answer no. I'm not going to take questions from Facebook. So I will respond to your Facebook question by saying that'll be the last one. Because, as you know, I view Facebook as a form of entertainment, as does Mrs. Glenister and everyone else, my spies on the Facebook world. And actually, I do look at some of those things for... You do get a lot of feedback. After the storm was a great method of feedback. I'm also contemplating how we can best get information that way. But the reason I'm not going to have that kind of blog stream of comments and questions is because when these come in through ICE, I have the ability to farm it out to the appropriate department that actually manages it. And then they can feedback the answer to you, which is good. And by the way, in a general statement, always make sure if you want feedback, put your name and contact information. You know, the anonymous thing, you know, maybe you think you're doing striking a blow for all the folks out there or something, but really we want to feed back to you what we're doing here. Sometimes the answers are inappropriate to be put out for everybody, especially if you call out an individual for bad service. We will obviously take care of that and take that seriously, but we're not going to call the person out. And we do want to let you know what happened with that. So please use ICE to do that, those ICE comments, and we'll keep those going. So there are some of these that I know they've been responded to, they've gone back to you. You're always going to have one at the customer service places, Starbucks, Chili's, Taco Bell, all those.
Housing.
Housing gets a lot. housing gets a lot. I think I've addressed some of those, not just the assignment policy, and I understand those, and I will take, you know, the brunt of those. The customer service ones do disturb me, though.
Yes.
When you were rude, I would just encourage everyone to, you know, what is being rude versus you don't like the answer and you know you're already kind of in a bad emotional state kind of thing. But there are some in here with actual specific examples which are completely unacceptable.
Yes, sir. And I noticed that on the comments from the director or manager in charge of that service, they actually address those. And like you said, sir, if you don't want to leave your name and you have a specific email address that we can respond to, at least we can get the feedback. Because in some of the cases in ICE, we actually need a lot more information because some of the comments are very generalized. And for example, MWR, large organization, really needs a little bit more specifics in some of those cases.
Right. So feel free, ask someone for their name. Don't say the tall woman who works at Building X. It's a big organization, and a lot of them are tenant commands too, so we don't know this person. So just feel free to say, hey, may I please take your name down? Either I want to say good things about you, or I'm going to report a nice comment. Maybe you can say it like that. But take their name down. We'll get that information. Okay, so here's one. I loved today's Friendship Day events. Obviously, some of these are a little older. The only detraction was when we were at the car show. I appreciate a good car stare as much as anyone, and I know for many, louder is better. I'm not sure I like louder is better, but I found inappropriate was the lyrics. One of the songs was playing at the International Family. I was repeating some profane music. Did you hear any of that stuff?
Reading the ICE comment was the first time I heard that, sir. I did go to the car show. It was a great car show, by the way. Yeah. But you're absolutely right. That type of music is inappropriate in that venue. And we're going to take a better look at that for our next car show.
Absolutely. I was went to the car show as well. I understand that the music was loud. I am not surprised that, based on the style of music they were playing, that one of the songs went in there had explicit lyrics. But we are going to have to put out very specific guidance on those kind of things. And, back when we used to have CDs that you bought instead of downloading, and that was kind of a standard that we had at any kind of shipboard event was, hey, if it has a sticker, it is not getting played during, family events, during actually maybe military events. We just would not play it over the thing. If you're going to use it, use your headphones because you have the right, to entertain yourself. But you're absolutely right. So we will take a round turn on that. Appreciate that comment. We'll weave that into our plan of action and milestones for the next event, which I think is the Mikoshi Parade.
Yes, sir.
I'm not sure we'll have the opportunity to blast loud music in a similar fashion, or this is part of that, but we'll definitely make sure that we put that in there as well. Okay, this one is for Ikego security. Most of us don't pay too much attention to them until we have to enter the base or need help off base after an accident. I would like to say thank you to all security guards and the Japanese, US and Japanese, at our gates. Been here for 3 years and have not once noticed them being unprofessional. Yeah, those have got some good folks out there. Actually, our OIC out there is also an MA.
Yes, sir, he is. MAC Guthrie. And I'll tell you, those Ikego office is very, they have very small staff, as with the security folks that we have out there, and they do a tremendous job with the number of people that reside out there. But our security department as a whole, those guys have a lot of responsibility on their plate that sometimes people take for granted. And, once in a while we get the, you have a bad day rule, and it can ruin people's days. But yeah, those guys that come in and they smile and they say good morning, they do a great job out there, sir. And they also have a lot of other responsibility that some people don't think about when they're walking through or driving through a gate.
Yeah, they do. Now, to counterbalance this point, most of the guys are doing a fantastic, and gals are doing fantastic. But there are some that, quite frankly, I've had to take away a badge.
Yes, sir.
I had to. Because the person just was not up to the standards. Basically, here was the standard, here was the person, they're gone. So by all means, if you get, not just bad service, but, we take very seriously any accusations or allegations of inappropriate behavior on part of any part of the CFA staff. security, obviously for security matters and those other things. But no, we absolutely, I mean, there are some comments like that. And the ones that are in there are actually very good. They actually name the person and what the incident was, the day, the time, because we're going to investigate it. And won't be CFE security investigating it either, by the way. So we do need that information to pass on to take a look at those things. And so by all means, do that. So we don't have, it's not all good news that comes in here. I mean, they are, anytime you have a feedback mechanism, it's going to be mostly negative. But I do like hearing these good ones as well.
That's a good story.
That's a good story. But we do have some negative ones in here as well. I'm not going to call those out necessarily because they do name people by name. And but we are going to take action on those. So as we have to. We should.
Yes.
Here's one. Been waiting for a while for the golfing range to be fixed, but nothing happened. And there is a later comment. As a golfer, this driving range is the number one thing that impacts my quality of life. It's been closed since my arrival in June, and no timetable for opening back up. Request info as to when this will reopen. Valid, legitimate question. Nothing against this. I understand what you're saying. When I was down in living in Texas, and I, by you know, golfing is in the eye of the beholder. I am by no means a golfer, other than the fact that I actually have gone to a driving range and a miniature golf course. So I feel I have both ends of the skills on that thing. I'm terrible. But I do appreciate imagining someone's particular face on a ball as I'm on a driving range. It is a good stress reliever. It's nice to have it convenient, just you know, knock a few balls out there. But related to this piece, it is not going to be fixed anytime soon. And it may seem absurd. It certainly seems absurd to me, the amount of dollars it would take to get that thing operational. It is.
It's approximately $500,000.
When they said it was like between 80 and 200, I thought that was crazy. But yes, it is very expensive. So, and I think we mentioned this last time, we are going to look at a few other options.
Yes, sir. There's actually some driving ranges right off the base, sir. There's a close one right there by Shiori Station across from the Dai Mall up the road a little bit. And although that might not be the answer that you want to hear, and yes, we would like to get the driving range open, it's okay to venture off base and try out the driving ranges and other options out there in town until we have the opportunity to take care of the driving range on the installation, sir.
Yeah, I think we also look at some MWR things as well. The machines and things?
Yes, sir. We're our MWR is researching the virtual driving range like you have in the States, basically driving a ball into the screen with the computer-generated simulation that goes with that. MWR also has a golf pro available as well who they can sign up through Purdy Gym, and I think right now he's doing his lessons out at the driving range off the installation. But the virtual golf, I mean, it we'll see what we can do with it, sir. It's going to be about dollars.
Yep, it is. My comments on the budget, notwithstanding earlier, we don't have as much flexibility as you might imagine in moving things around. So we have certain funding, which is called non-appropriative funds. Those things that make money. So in a lot of bases in the United States, the golf course is a business. It has to make money. It's not really subsidized. Now there are some differences out here in Oconus, as we say, outside the continent of the United States. But those non-appropriated fund things got to be a business maker. Things like the clubs and things have to take in more money than they spend. So the fact that we make money in one part of the morale, welfare, and recreation arena does not mean we can take it and move it to those other things. So we have very tight controls. As you would imagine, Congress and others say, thou shalt spend this money on this thing, and we just don't have a lot of flexibility. So though we may have money for other things, other projects, you may see some, well, we're building this thing and that thing is just sitting there. Yeah, that's usually why. So again, not the answer you may have been looking for, but that is the answer. Here's a comment. Actually, it's a pretty good idea. Not sure how to proceed on this one just yet. Some of these comments are so new they have not been responded to yet, but I thought this was interesting enough to look at. I enjoy visiting Starbucks on base. The beverages and food taste great, and the service is always kind and courteous. I agree. I go there every weekend with my kids. Not that they want to turn into caffeine junkies, but I'm a caffeine junkie, and they like to watch me drink coffee. So there is, however, one way I feel the customer service and satisfaction could improve is by adding to the store the capability of processing payment through the Passbook app on the iPhone 5. And it goes in through why that's a good idea. And there's a lot of other good ideas in here. Now, there are some restrictions on any kind of funding type stuff, credit card swiping and other stuff. I agree, it would be nice for that. We don't always have the ability to interface with them. There are certain contracts that go into place and how they're going to accept these things. And there, of course, there are some issues with installing a new means of funding things.
Yes, there is, sir.
You may want to dip into a little bit of history here, a little before my time, but you don't have to be specific, but you can just talk about some of the dangers. Thinking in particular, there was another establishment where we had a
credit card fraud.
Credit card fraud, yeah, a while back now.
And that service, that was over a year ago, Kevin, and that service actually has just started taking credit cards again. So there's always a risk when we start using the new, lack of a better term, gizmos. Because
there are
people that can intercept and steal your identity and make charges on your account. So, but it's something that the next can pass on, and
they can. We will look at that. And just so you know, it's more to it than we're scared of something because of the way we operate over here. Some of these things that seem to be very quick, like call Starbucks corporate up and say, can we do this? You have Wi-Fi that's being provided, not necessarily by Starbucks. It may be provided by another user like NWR.
Yes, sir.
You may have AmeriCable riding the backbone of some of these things, and there's a sharing agreement on how we do that back to the servers in Japan, which is why you know that your IP address is a Japanese IP address. If you Google, you know that, and those kind of things. So we'll pass this on and ask them to take a look at that. But if they don't right away, it's not because they don't want the business, because obviously it's a good decision for them. But there are some considerations that we just don't have back in CONUS when we ask that. Okay, next one. The Bird Community School. We actually talked about this one last time, I believe, which is the combination of some grades at Bird Elementary out there and our good friends in Nagishi, who actually I'm going out there later today.
Yes, sir, you are.
Bird School community would like an explanation as to why there were changes to the grade level groupings. For those of you who don't know, they have a combined classes, very dwindling student body out there, more or less. We are not assigning people out into Nagishi right now. We are committed to making sure that Nagishi has all the services and those things, like everybody else, but there is a bit of attrition going on as we don't assign people, and the population of the school is getting smaller and smaller, or aging out. Some of the kids are now going to go to high school, or middle school, and things like that. And so I'll address this comment. It was addressed, I don't think adequately, but the short answer to the of what I read, there's a lot more to this, obviously. There's a lot of emotion in this particular comment related to the some personalities and some teachers and things like that. But the short answer is that the age groupings are what are deemed the most manageable and executable for the education of the students. And that is done in conjunction with the principal, the teachers, the DODEA, which is the DOD education folks, and the superintendent, just like you would have a school elsewhere. And that is how the decisions were made. Now, related to some of the other comments, and I would just like to take this opportunity to say that, you know, although this is federal, DOD, unlike your state, in the U.S., a popular question I quiz young men about when I'm testing them for some citizenship things is who in the United States is responsible for the care and feeding the health and welfare of the citizens? And you get a whole continuum of answers. But I'll tell you what the answer is not. It is not the Congress and it is not the President of the United States. That is the federal government. It is the governor of the state who is responsible for that, which is why states run, generally speaking, when you're in a state, states run things like fire, police, schools, board of education, schools all fall under the state for that very reason, health and welfare of the citizenry. We're in a federal thing. So that's why you elected a school board, you have superintendent of schools and those kind of things. So, but I would encourage you is, although this is a federal entity, don't disregard the parallels and those kind of things you would do as a parent, okay? So if you would call for a teacher conference, call for a teacher conference. If you want to talk to the principal, talk to the principal. If you want to talk to the superintendent of the schools, go through the principal. But make those arrangements and do that, just like you would. There's a lot of folks who, on both sides of the education spectrum, who think that they have the greater interest in education. I have failed to find a parent who's not more interested in the success of their children than anyone else. You know, as parents, we're only as happy as our saddest child. Okay, and what happens to them and their education is of critical importance. And you obviously have to take that on as well. And when you have issues with the teachers and issues with the way things are being run, by all means, join the PTO or PTA or PTG, whatever they call it. Take an active role in the joint shared responsibility for the education and the well-being of our kids at school. Volunteer at the school. Do those things. That information is out there on how to do that. And, there's not too much more to say on that. One more plug on those things. Schools have their administrative requirements for discipline and those types of things. That is not a substitute for the discipline that would happen on base. So, for instance, if someone shoplifts at the exchange, they call security. In addition to the exchange telling you that, we're going to put your face up there or something. But and the same is true at the school. I mean, the school is going to handle it, do the discipline thing. If you think there's something criminal, then by all means, either you or the school is going to contact security. But you always have that option, okay, for that kind of stuff. So treat it, like it is back in the States. Would you call the police in addition to the principal? If it's that serious, by all means, contact security. If you would like to talk to the principal or the school board and you would go downtown, by all means, make arrangements to do that. And we'll get you the contact information you need to do that.
Yes, sir.
I think that's probably enough on that one. Okay. I'd like to know if there's been any forward movement about changing the arrival time of the Nagishi to home to work bus to 0600. I think the forward movement on the decision has been rapid and there, but we're not going to change it. Okay. We talked about this last time, and again, it may not be the most satisfying answer you're going to get, but because we are only going to stick with the one bus in Nagishi, we've got to make sure that we keep those times based on usage and making sure we get people there in time.
Yes, sir.
I think we addressed that adequately last time. We are adding back. It's the good folks at Public Works, NAVFAC, actually. Commander McLemore and his team, looking at the usage of the Kago bus, have added a second bus, which is now back.
Yes.
And they say, looking for, and they found some money. And that is not trivial, by the way. To find money just means that they had to reprioritize and do some things. And we are going to try and keep that going in the new fiscal year as we can. And it's based on usage. And we got the 520 bus back at Akego. And it's not being as heavily used. I'm sure it will very soon, though. And as much as the later bus. But they're both back there. Keep using them. That's why they're there. When those go away. And, by the way, they are for home to work, not for students. Although on a space available basis, last stop, some
students can get out at the last
after all the military members.
Yes.
That's what they are for. Okay. Okay. Question about the, could you please let me know when the paint booth will be available for use at the auto hobby shop? It's been down for several months. I understand the contractor has provided a cost estimate to repair the booth. Will MWR fund the repairs, or should I seek alternatives off base? Well, you should always seek alternatives off base, because you should always have a plan B or C or D, or as deep in the alphabet as you need to go, to get your life to normal and do what you want to do. I don't want to be so cavalier as to say that's what COLA is for. COLA is cost of living allowance. It's supposed to make up the difference in the fact that doing some things out in town may cost more. There's a later comment on veterinary services and things like
yes,
that.
Sir.
They cost more out in town. And when things are not available because of, schedules of the individuals that work here, whatever, you do have to go out in town. So I would definitely, absolutely, don't put your life on hold because some things are not coming back as fast as we'd like them. But, so the answer is we obviously are committed to having as much quality service activities available for you as we can. But I think we are kind of at an operational pause on this one until we can get the funding back or
money.
Some things happen. It's all about the Benjamins. I am a dependent on base, highly concerned when I learned that at AOB ICR that longboarding is going to be banned. Don't know what this is about again. We'll have to pull that string. This is the second time I've got that comment, and this one was from the 1st of September. So I don't know that longboarding is going to be banned. I will share with you, I've seen people without helmets racing around base. Does not make me feel good. Provided that everyone continues to follow the rules, I think we're in good shape there.
The skateboarding is authorized on the installation at this mm-hmm. time. I haven't seen an official announcement saying it's not going to. And they are required to have PPE on. They do have to have a helmet on. And trick board skating is supposed to be done in our skate park over by Purdy Gym.
Yes.
Nowhere else. Yes, sir.
So if you haven't seen that facility, it's pretty neat. And you should make yourself known to that facility if you like to do trick skateboarding. It's pretty good. All right, I think the last one we're going to go through here is one, again, ripped from the headlines here, so new, but we got to pull the string on this one. Had a conversation with Housing Services Center, and disappointed to find out my office would not accept copies, even certified copies, of documents like frocking letters. My husband was recently promoted to E7, and while I understand he cannot apply for housing until the 13th, I am now unable to apply at all because he's deployed. So they have a copy of this frocking letter that says he's now in E7, and I guess according to this, housing was not taking it.
My understanding is this is someone who is newly arrived mm-hmm. to Yokosuka,
right.
And they're trying to get on the senior enlisted list. They should be able to accept that frocking letter. There is an alternative. The FAST office at the Community Readiness Center can reach out to the SHIP. And if it's received, we can ask the FAST office. But I don't see an issue being able to accept a copy of paperwork from the command. And that's many of us are in that position all the time.
Right. There's again, FAST office. We'll be able to help you out with that. I will share with you that in my wife's experience the last time we were here. Hey, there are just a lot of things that it is not like being in CONUS. Things are sometimes restrictive in what you can do on your own. And sometimes you need a certified copy, sometimes you need a power of attorney, and all these other things. And you might say, why? Well, the answer is that, I'm not going to say there's an opportunity for fraud or any other kind of things, but we do require you to have certified all this documentation. We are in Japanese territory. There are certain requirements for these things. That's not always the reason. There's a whole bevy of reasons out there. But this one, it seems like you should be able to use your frocking letter and get on that list. Now, having said that, we are going to take a look when we revise the housing policy. What does it mean to be a select? As I often said, Captain Select is abbreviated capital C, capital D, capital R. I was selected for 05 for 16 months before I pinned on. And then once I did, I was already here. And of course, I'm not going to move. One, because it's a hassle to move. But related to that, just because you are now qualified for a new category, be it new additions to the family, congratulations if you're in that category, or you're promoted, congratulations if you're in that category. It costs money to move. There are certain restrictions against what's called intrastation moves. And we're not allowed to pay for them except for certain circumstances.
Yes, sir.
Once we're all full up, and not totally full, obviously, but once we have met our mandate of getting everyone who's coming in housing, and there are houses available, I am not opposed to investigating whether it's even legal, I think it is, for folks to move themselves if they wanted to. This is no different than when you're back in CONUS and you decide you don't like the apartment complex you're living in or your landlord's not going to renew your lease, and you get some friends and some refreshments and you call in all your favors and get some trucks and boxes, and you move yourself. So it is not really that different in doing that kind of stuff. But I'm not opposed to looking at that. So not to say it's going to happen right away, but say, hey, you were now, congratulations, you're now a chief, and now you're eligible for a certain size house, and we have that house available, and we're not being crushed by a mandate to get everyone else in there first. Then, again, if it's not illegal, immoral, cost the government money, or make someone else feel bad, I'm generally all for it. So we'll try and take a look and see that possibility. But as far as taking the documentation, we'll have to pull the string on that. I think that should be okay as proof that of your pay grade, which really would, if I read this correctly, you're looking for proof of pay grade, that should be good. So, all right. So I think that's everything we were scheduled on covering here. I appreciate you spending your time with us. We're going to try and air these every Thursday. It'll be whatever the last one was. So if it seems like a little bit of deja vu, you may not be mistaken. You may be seeing us again and again. But thank you for your time. Thank you for your comments. Please keep them objective to the extent possible. I understand there's a venting mechanism here. But we want to try and get to resolution on these things. So include your information so we can email back to you what the resolution was or what the explanation was. And if you have good suggestions, I love those. Sometimes we can't do them. And we'll try to explain that why, too. But keep those coming as well. So that's it. Have a great week, great couple weeks, until we see you next time.